Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
Hey, what's going on, guys? This is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV, YouTube channel for dog lovers. If you guys haven't already, please go ahead and subscribe to the channel. I'm pretty sure you guys have already subscribed, though, because you're here early, bright and early. Today, I have a conversation I'm having with a guy that I respect a lot, a guy that has spent a lot of time, dedicated a lot of energy and his considerable intellect into canine behavior, training dogs, working with dogs. Mr. John Anthony of Redemption Road Canine. How's it going, hey. My man?
Oh, it's beautiful. It's about 10 o'clock here in Atlanta.
Nice, just nice. Chilling. I was saying you look like you're in a suite in Vegas, though. You got the candles going. Nah,
this is our office here at the new facility, Redemption Road Canine South. We're in the process of opening up the new facility here in Atlanta, and this is the office.
All right. Okay. Well, listen, what I wanted to do first, I know we're going to talk about protection dogs, the pros and cons. But what I wanted to do is we did a documentary, about a 15-minute documentary, and I wanted to let that play and let them get to know who you are in your own words, understand a certain level of your accreditations, your credits, what you've done. They'll get familiar with you through the video. And then we'll come back and we'll talk about protection dogs.
All right. Sounds good.
Let's do it. Here's the video, guys. This is Redemption Road, the story of the Redemption Road.
Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
All right, spotting the dog. We're coming to the end of the line. We've caught the dog. We take one more step. Now look how I am and look how you are. No, you're coming to the end there. Now you caught the dog, open up. Now you're transitioning. No. Redemption Road Canine is a cynology center located right outside of LA in the city of Santa Clarita. We specialize in, among other things, canine conditioning, fitness, nutrition, training. We do assist with some breeding programs that we've been brought in as partners, and a ton of research. Keep coming, catch the dog, clear the junk. Very nice. We are right now in Agua Dulce, which is an exurb of the city of Santa Clarita. We're at Redemption Road Canine Ranch. The ranch itself is a little over 10 acres, or 400,000 square feet. We have three training fields here. We have a barn that we've converted to military grade kennels, and we have an assortment of animals and livestock. The Coliseum, as we call it, and that's our protection field. There we have confidence cage, we have a targeting table, we have things that pertain to the sports that I practice and decoy in. So we got French ring, we got some Mondio ring, and then we have some PSA stuff. A brevet is just a test of courage. You know, you can start getting in the upper levels of PSA and ring. They're opening things up at less than a meter. That one I opened up probably less than a meter. That was good. Good work, OG. Cynologist is a dog scientist, someone who studies domestic canid species. And I met a cynologist from the UK who blew my mind. I didn't even know this was a job. And her entire job was to go around studying wild dogs in different locations and then drawing comparisons with domestic canids. So she'd been to India and Taiwan and Japan, a bunch of places to study the wild dogs, and I just thought that was fascinating. So I kept in contact with her, and she's kind of been guiding me on my efforts. And for us, what we do and what I do here, I study domestic canids and in particular canine learning theory, how to best teach a dog things that benefit mankind with the least amount of aversives and corrections, I guess you'd call them. At Redemption Row Canine, we believe that all dogs are working dogs. Because two of my first dogs were, I guess to some extent, rescues, I developed a passion. I started in the shelter world, working with troubled dogs, aggressive dogs, dogs that have been abandoned, abused dogs. So I found that to be fulfilling, and I found a certain kind of therapy within that work. So our approach here has been to offer both dogs and people a chance at a second chance at life, really. Being involved in the dog world as a trainer, as a researcher, as an educator, and as a certified decoy, I've got a chance to learn a lot about a lot of different breeds. And I have a pretty diverse group of dogs here. I have an Anatolian Shepherd, or Kangal, as they're known in Turkey, named Attilius of Anatolia. Right now we're working on preparing him for some movie work. I want to really tighten up our distant sign language and his ability to place onto a platform or a place marker. Basically, I'm going to be using my hands at a close proximity and then proofing that, increasing the distance and duration over time. But right now, like, down. Down. Using marker training to mark when he does it. Attilius, sit. That's it. Attilius is a really awesome dog. He's 2 years old. Attilius of Anatolia, our Kangal, does have double dew claws on all four. And I know that there's some debate about what to do with these. For me personally, I don't believe nature has very many inefficiencies, so I don't alter my dogs in any way. He's a very big boy. He has about 6 different titles. And he works primarily, though, in right now as a livestock guardian. I know there are people who disagree with that idea of livestock guardianship, but here on the ranch we have 10 acres and we have an assortment of livestock that needs protection against predation, because I'm not an advocate of killing coyotes and killing wolves and foxes and things like that. My goal in introducing the Anatolian here on the ranch and in Southern California is to introduce a way to positively coexist with the wildlife that exists here. So my Anatolians are not trained in any way, shape, or form to go kill anything. They're trained to bark, alert, and deter predation against our livestock. Cerberus. Cerberus of Hades is a DDR, German Shepherd. He's a great dog. Very particular personality, but he loves me. He works hard for me. He's training in apprehension and in the sport of French ring. And he'll probably get some detection work done. And this is more stuff for inside the house. I have my dogs inside the house. Go to your bed. Good, go to your bed. Go to your bed. Good. Now, we'll introduce kind of the next step of it. So, go to your bed. Down. Good. Itai of Gaith, or Goth, depending on where you're from. Itai is a Rottweiler with German bloodlines. Great dog. He's about 9 months old. And so far, we've just been socializing him here, getting him used to life on the ranch, accustomed to working within the confines of a pack, and then really, really getting him used to being around animals that he can't engage, because he's got some pretty substantial prey drive. Xerxes of Persis. She's our second Anatolian, a new addition to the pack. She is a brindle Anatolian Shepherd, and she's a dream. She's here to work alongside the Rottweiler Itai and Attilius in terms of protecting the property from predation. All right, so this is a raw fur that I bought from a taxidermist. And with my Anatolians, I'm not particularly interested in them aggressing against man or anything like that. They're here to protect the livestock, protect the birds, you know, the guinea fowl, the ducks, the rabbits, and the horses and whatnot. So I start my puppies pretty young, my livestock guardians, on what I want them to be alerting on. So this is just kind of a game to get her interested. Yeah. Yes, girl. So I have clients from all walks of life, and on any given day, meet a celebrity actor, a professional athlete, a billionaire investor, a federal marshal, current gang member, a former gang member, all at the same time. Because of that fact, because we have such a diverse clientele base, we are able to do some really interesting things. We've traveled to Dubai, South Korea, Japan, Vietnam, all under the auspices of dog training. And most recently, we took a trip to Van Nuys private airport, and we were able to board and hang out, fly around on a private jet. It was a G55 Gulfstream that belongs to a client, and we got to drive our cars onto the tarmac and bring our dogs. It was really awesome. Everybody enjoyed the trip. It was just kind of a dog training exercise. We got a chance to socialize our dogs. We got a chance to get them on and off a plane, have them around flight crew, see how they respond in the air, being in crates in the air, these kinds of things. So it was really just a training exercise, but it was to set the stage for our eventual Noah's Ark flight, where we were going to fly to either an actual trial or a mock trial in some other part of the U.S. Our training philosophy here at Redemption Row Canine starts with the health and wellness of the dog. I believe all training programs should start first and foremost and have as a priority what's best for the dog. I know in the sport world and a lot of times in the protection world, sometimes we can put our agenda above the well-being of the dog. You know, we need you to down, sit, stay, come, you know, stallion, search, transport. We need you to do that when we say do it. And for me, I start with health and wellness. After health and wellness, I go to nutrition. Nutrition is a big thing, and as a certified canine food formulator, I really, really, really am a stickler for great dog nutrition. We also have about 13 different supplements, goat's milk. We use all kinds of things here, electrolytes, and from health and wellness to nutrition, then comes engagement. And everyone who's ever worked with me will tell you that my thing is positive bonding with the dog. I'd like to believe, and if you look at the breed standards, all of my dogs fit well within the breed standards. I do prefer leaner dogs, but as you can see with the amount of space we have here and just the sheer amount of engagement, it's for their best. Like it's for their best interest. For instance, my Anatolian right now at 2 years old is 135. Some people might consider that underweight, but his growth plates just closed, you know, not too long ago. So for me to have put a bunch of weight on him would have potentially impacted his long-term development. And because the Anatolian's life expectancy is 12 to 14 years, I'm never in a rush with any of my dogs. So they are lean, but they're athletic. They're athletes, you know, we have elite canine athletes here. Extra weight on a dog, just it has so many consequences. So for me, my dogs on average are taking between 45 and 60,000 steps a day. Because I know that, I have Fitbits on them, I'm able to adjust their food to keep them at the weight that I believe to be desirable. And for a dog that is waking up in the morning, dragging a tire, then doing some sprints, hill sprints, then potentially some agility, they're gonna get their midday nutrition, and there'll be supplements added to that. We use Red Cell Canine, we use goat's milk, Nupro, multivitamin. I mean, we have a ton of different things we use. I think a lot of times people can confuse proper nutrition with the amount, and a lot of people feel that if they feed their dogs more, their dogs are getting more, and we don't believe that here at Redemption Row Canine. On average, dogs are gonna digest about 20 to 30% worth of the nutrients in their kibble. So even with our kibble, we blend it down to a powder. We hydrate the kibble with their daily water requirements, and that's gonna raise the percentage of absorption to probably 50, 60% on kibble alone. So I would argue that despite being lean, my dogs are probably some of the healthiest dogs in the world right now. Redemption Row Canine, in a nutshell, is a group of people, a family of misfits who've come together under the premise of training dogs, learning about dogs, dog management, husbandry, canine learning theory. Everyone who comes here knows that they have a support system. We don't place any pressure on handlers or dogs. It's difficult in a world that can be very dogmatic. So we really challenge a lot of the dogmatic notions of what a dog's supposed to do and try to enhance what the dog already does. So if you have a dog that likes looking for you, then we're going to try to utilize that in terms of searching. If we have a dog that drives on a ball, or a dog that loves biting things, you know, we're just going to try to take that and enhance upon it. And if you just want a dog that loves you, that's going to go to its bed when it's told, not go to the bathroom in the house, we specialize in that. So here it's all about the bond between the owner and the dog, doing what's best for the dog, and then enhancing what the dog already brings to the table. Happy dog, happy handlers. I get to it first, I got you mad. I guess that when I get
to it last. All right, guys, that was the video, the story of Redemption Row. Let me bring back Jonathan. John, I don't know if it's Jonathan. What's going on, man? Who's your partner? Oh, who's on the sofa with you?
Oh, this is my man, Crixus, right now.
We start of the video.
Yeah, we enjoying a little Japanese whiskey, and he's having, what are these? Sweet potato chips. Right. Homemade sweet potato chips.
My man. Crixus is a health nut.
Yeah, he is. He worked hard for me today. He did about 30 hill sprints.
Oh, nice.
Work protection. Yeah, he's going to have a good dinner. I've got something lined up for him.
All right, perfect. So, John, please tell me, man, the topic today, we're talking about protection dogs. It's kind of been the theme of the week. I've been really... I'll kind of state my position first and foremost. You know, I deal with a lot of people who I would consider to be very experienced and well-versed in dog ownership, dog training, experienced dog people. And one of the things that I find on my channel is a lot of people have this, like, gung-ho notion of, I'm going to get a protection dog, I'm going to get a guard dog, and if anybody comes in my house, he's going to tear them up. You know, and I think that's a great idea. It's like me when I was, 18 years old and I wanted to get a motorcycle, right? Like, oh, I'm going to get this motorcycle. I'm going to be doing 150 on the freeway. Like, yeah, calm down, man. There's a lot of other things that go into riding a motorcycle. There's a wide spectrum of possibilities when you get on something that fast with just two wheels. And when you're dealing with an animal, a dog, different dog breeds, there's a wide spectrum of possibilities when you train them to do certain jobs. And I just think that a lot of people are a little naive in their expression or their comprehension of owning a protection dog, a guard dog, or a watchdog. First and foremost, I always like to have people, give me, because, the words mean different things to different people. Your definition of a watchdog, I'm sorry, a protection animal versus a guard dog.
Right. So let me first start with, there are many people who are drastically more qualified to speak on guard dogs and attack dogs than I am. I believe what makes me qualified to speak on this matter is not many of these people have had a dog get a live bite. And certainly not many of these people have been arrested for it. I feel comfortable now expressing that, having gone through it. I was arrested for this. I was arrested for my dog getting a bite and a 422 in Los Angeles County. It's criminal threatening and terrorism. And it's a terrifying thing. This was not like me out on the street being irresponsible. This was me at my house.
Tell a story, please.
Yeah, I was at my house confronting trespassers. I just purchased my place when I got it in LA a few years ago. And these people were basically treating my property like a park, which is odd because I live right down the street from one of the most famous national parks in the world. So I approached them. I had the dog with me. Hey, I'm the new owner. Can I help you? Now, let me just take a couple steps back. My driveway, as you know, is about 2.5 miles long, right? So, like, they had to trespass. Right. They trespassed all the way trespassed. They ended up on the property. They had backpacks and like they were walking and I approached them. Hey, you know, I'm the new owner. Can I help you? No, we're just out for a hike. Well, nice to meet you, but this is private property. And I was literally in the middle of working dogs, some pretty serious dogs at that particular moment. And the guy was responsible. You need to get fucking fencing. And I'm like, be that as it may, you're still trespassing. Can I ask that maybe we have this conversation another time? And you got picked, bro. Lay down. Good boy. You know, and so that kind of went on for a second. And then at one point, he kind of got a little aggressive. And the dog naturally did what the dog is supposed to do. And 6 days later, the LA County Sheriff showed up to my house and arrested me for criminal threatening terrorism. The DA had that case for about 75 seconds before they threw it out. Because you can be arrested and not be charged. Go lay down. Go lay down. They can have that. You can be arrested and not be charged. So they threw it out with prejudice, as far as I know. And but in the meantime, they held me, right? Because without getting too deep into it, there were people who were trying to prove a point to me in this community. So this particular charge is a wobbler, which means it can be a misdemeanor, it can be a felony. Despite the fact that nobody was hurt at that moment, they charged me with a felony. They put the bail at $75,000. $75,000. Now, I got tattoos and they have nothing to do. I'm not gang affiliated. I don't do none of that. But the cop, because he was affiliated with the person who had been trespassing, was like, well, because I can't understand your tattoos, I'm going to classify them as gang tattoos and we're sending you downtown. So I'm like, what? So at that point, it's like, all right, now I got to bail out because I'm not really trying to go downtown, right? So I had to bail out $7,500 for that, $21,000 for the lawyer, only to have this thrown out. So that is what qualifies me to have this conversation in terms of like the viability of a guard dog, attack dog, protection dog. I wanted to start with that because I know you know how the dog world is. There's gonna be people, oh, he only been in the game for this long. He's only done these many things. What I have done is probably spent close to $90,000 on learning this particular lesson. So hopefully people who watch this and trainers who watch this can give their clients information that's gonna arm them to be successful with these dogs. And hopefully clients will then arm themselves with this information and go out so that they don't have to learn the same way I do, the same way I did, because it was a traumatic experience for sure.
Right. So let's get into the let's get into the definition, because obviously, you know, a protection animal, a guard dog, a watchdog, there's three different things. Sometimes I talk to people and the concept of a guard dog is just simply a dog that will bite someone, right? If even whether it be, but I was having a conversation earlier today with a gentleman who said, no, a guard dog is a dog that you just, to me, the way he described them was like a junkyard, a dog that just left in the area that will guard anything. So tell me, give me your definition. Yeah, give me your definitions.
So I can actually read it because we've defined it. We need to be clear on these things if we're going to be potentially weaponizing dogs that go out in the community. We need to be clear on what it is we do. So Redemption Row Canine defines a protection dog as trained to protect a moving subject, usually a person, through directed aggression and to disengage upon command. This is to be contrasted with the guard dog, which protects a stationary object, an alarm dog, which alerts, and an attack dog, which is trained to attack on command or on sight. The difference between these types of dogs is in how they are trained and the types of situations they are utilized in. Protection dogs are often, you know, utilized in situations where you're out in the world. So for me, the difference that I see on a day-to-day basis is the ability to engage and disengage on command. That's a huge difference. And, you know, having been called in as an expert witness in Superior Court and Municipal Court, and I guess Federal Court, I've had to be able to make that distinction and make those arguments, depending on, you know, which case you're looking at, but be able to make those arguments in a compelling way scientific way that will speak to a jury.
The concept attack dog, explain that one to me, because
dog is going to do his job. He is not, or she's not, waiting for a command. And generally speaking, they're not going to out. They're not going to disengage. We at the Redemption Canine, we call them burner dogs. These dogs generally don't have a microchip. There's no delineating information on their collars. That's the kind of dog that bites somebody and you get in your car and you leave.
Right.
That dog is, right? See you. Thank you for the help. Goodbye. That to me is an attack.
Okay.
And we don't train attack dogs here. We don't participate in that.
I was going to say, I don't know too many people that train for attack dogs. I mean, I know guard dogs and obviously personal protection dogs. I've worked with people who do that kind of work. So let me ask you this. So protection animals, does everyone need one? And if not, who does?
After having gone through what I went through, what I will say is the idea sounds very nice. It's a very compelling idea. You know, you buy this puppy, $2,000, $3,000, for some people, $4,000 or $5,000, and you find a club or a trainer, and then you pay another $10,000 to $15,000 to get this dog trained to basically bark to let you know something's off, and then to potentially engage with whatever is causing the offness. For those people who know me and have trained with me and just around me, I like to pride myself on being fairly prepared for most things. I like to think of myself as my own primary source of protection. I do have dogs that work in protection sports, and I have dogs that I trust with my family and with my possessions. But realistically, you know, we were talking about it earlier, the difference between kind of opportunity crimes and, you know, the petty theft that was taking place back in the 80s and early 90s. I think criminals are a little more sophisticated than that now. The chances of petty crime happening to you, somebody just walking by your house, like, oh, I'm going to break into that one on my way to school. Like, that's not likely. So chances are whatever criminal has decided to enter your place or your car or whatever, they have done their research and they are also coming prepared. So I'm not going to send my dog personally into that type of battle. My dog is there to kind of give me a second to get to my, get myself oriented to protect myself. Realistically, right. That's kind of how I see it. I don't know how viable it is, because the laws, especially in LA, and in particular, like LA County, are not geared to, they're not meant for protection dogs. Like, injuries inflicted by a dog that is trained to attack can result in the conviction of second degree murder and other felonies, such as set forth by California's Penal Code 399. I think if you're going to have a protection dog, you want to read 399, because your dog doesn't even actually have to bite for you to be legally liable. It's terrifying. One of the cases that I was a subject matter expert on, I testified as an expert. A kid had walked onto a property trespassing to engage a dog that he had heard. In getting to the gate, he realized that the gate wasn't actually a gate. It wasn't all the way around. So the dog is now engaging this kid. Kid turns around to run, trips, and chips his teeth. I actually testified in this case. Do you know that boy walked away with $170,000? Because for the insurance, it's easier to just settle. They don't want to go through it. Right. And as the person, if the dog had hypothetically gotten the bite, you are now on the hook for that bite. First question is going to be, is your dog in compliance in LA County? Is the dog registered? Do you have the dog vaccinated? And do you have a number associated with that registration and that vaccination? If not, you've already lost your case.
Right.
These are the things that I'd want to know as a client, and the things that I'd want to educate my clients on as a trainer. There was another case where the dog had jumped to greet this particular person, a neighbor, in fact, and scratched them. And they sued for being scratched. What you have to think about is, what is the jury's experience going to be with dogs? And in particular, a dog that you have made a concerted effort to train to hurt humans.
Right.
In that case, the jury looked at that scratch and called it a nip. That nip was worth $56,000. So these kinds of weird situations are not really set up for you to be successful as a protection dog owner unless you've done your research, unless you are working with a group or with a trainer who is also familiar with these laws. And at that particular time, when my situation went down, I didn't know that. We watched things like Cops or America's Top Dog or any of these shows, you know, PD Live, and like you hear the police say, I'm going to send the dog. Sounds great in theory, but to say that to another human person as a civilian in LA County is to threaten them with substantial bodily harm, i.e. a 422, criminal threatening and terrorism. Because that's ultimately what I said to the guy trespassing is, look, you're getting upset. I'm not sure why you're getting upset. The next time we see each other, it will not be a diplomatic conversation. I will treat you like a trespasser. And that's what the police came and arrested me for, right? So to answer your question, I don't know how viable it is for the everyday person to protection dog.
Let me ask you this. First of all, let's talk about, you kind of broke down the cost of having a protection dog. Give me one second. You don't mind if I drink some Japanese whiskey, do you? Have a sip, would you please? What's going on?
What's going on?
All right, let me try this.
Write down stuff like imputable negligence. You want to look these kinds of things up, you know, if you're considering taking on a protection dog, because it's very serious.
Yeah, we definitely have an issue. Yeah, we definitely have an issue with the audio.
I don't know what's doing this.
And I think California is a strict liability state, right? If I'm not mistaken. Oof. There's no echo on my side anymore.
Do you hear me?
I hear the echo still.
Oh, this is horrible.
You may have to do all the talking.
check. Sorry, guys, this is kind of one of the things that happened. One, two. I'm still hearing it. Okay, let me just get my question. I don't want to make this point. What amount of time and effort does it take for a person to get themselves? A capable protection animal to help them around the house.
Oof. I would say you should probably think between 10 and 20 hours a week initially. And then if we take the absolute bare minimum, like let's say what LAPD has to do monthly, 14 hours a month in maintenance. So you're looking at, you know, a full-time job pretty much to have a viable protection.
So we're looking at how much time? $20,000. Based against the likelihood of you, you know, chances of anyone breaking your house is small.
Very small.
And So for me, I've kind of decided that I didn't necessarily need a protection animal. But what I would love to do is enhance his watchdog skills. skill set. Do you do any training for that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think for a dog to be able to alert, and I'm very particular because I started in the medical service world. So when we're teaching a medical service dog a particular medical alert, it needs to be ironclad, you know, 95% success rate in the dog's ability to deliver this behavior. So yeah, I mean, I think that's more than enough for most people. Now, they're the fringe cases, right? You live in the projects maybe, and you got all of this going on, and maybe you run in the wrong circles. But even that is a nightmare, because if you live in the projects, chances are you can't have pets. And if you can, there's a breed restriction on anything that's going to be able to actually protect you. So I think looking at the cost, and I know there's going to be a bunch of trainers upset with me for this, but you know, $25,000, $35,000, $40,000, you could probably just hire a private security guard for that amount of money. I don't know how many guns you can buy with $40,000, but I imagine it's a substantial amount of guns. That's a good amount of mace, taser gun. I mean, you know, there's just so many other options. But I get it. I understand. And like, I think when you factor in women with protection dogs, that's a very different situation, because right, they are more susceptible to spontaneous criminal opportunities.
Right. Let me do this. I'm gonna kick you out for a second and just call me back. Let me see if that fixes audio issue, because it's driving me crazy.
Okay.
All right, let's do this. All right, guys. Sorry about that. I don't know what's going on, man. This is, you know, we've been doing this for about a week now. I never had that issue before. Hopefully it'll call back in. Hopefully it'll kind of fix itself. I'm looking through the settings on this thing here. It doesn't really give me options to fix it. Let's see. All right, you back?
Back.
No echo?
Echo.
No echo? No echo.
I don't hear no echo.
Can you hear me? That's good. Perfect. All right. So that's gonna be the fix moving forward. Just kill a call and bring it back. So we kind of talked about the viability, the affordability, the practicality of a protection animal, but yet you still protection train. It's still a big thing. What would you say is the beauty and advantages of engaging in it? Because I think that, you know, if you have the money, you have the time. I know a lot of people that do this are retired, so they have money and they have time. It is interesting. It is fun. It's exciting. Speak to the value in doing it.
Yeah, I think for me, the value for me and for Redemption Road Canine is that it's more of a leadership academy that we have here. I think people come seeking a certain kind of a self-realization and self-actualization, and we're able to provide that. They come looking for a better relationship with their dog, and they leave with better nonverbal communication skills, better incentivization skills, a better ability to read the room, to lead, pack leadership. These kinds of things, I think, are why people come here. Because we're not cheap, but you walk away with more than just a dog that can sit, stay, come, and, you know, growl at people. But for me, I think personally, I've gotten 3 calls, one from an officer. His dog did the job, and he called me really kind of emotional, thanking me for helping him get home to his family. I had a Navy guy call me and tell me that his dog chased a bear out of a campsite. I can't take full credit for that, but we did do some very strange training, and it worked out. I would not suggest sending your dog on a bear ever. His dog got absolutely lucky, but it did save some people in their tent. And then personally, in my own life, my dogs have protected my family on 2 specific occasions where they did the work, and it was awesome work. And I'm very proud of them. So I don't want people to think I'm down on protection dogs. I think it's great. I think anything you can do to increase your bond with your dog is great. but I wouldn't go into this allowing other people to define what success is relative to a protection dog for you. And I think the sports can kind of do that. The sports can have you convinced that your dog is weak, or that your dog, you know, you should get rid of it, or that whatever version of that shit that they spew. I think if you love your dog and your dog loves you and your dog is willing to take on another creature walking the planet 5-6 times its size, even if it's gonna lose, that dog gets a seat at my table, at our table here at Redemption Row Canine. If you're gonna bark and let me know there's a coyote, if you're gonna protect my guinea fowl, if you're gonna do anything like that, I'm fine with it. You know, I think it's viable in that setting. But I think if you own any asset at all and you wanna keep it, make sure you do your due diligence in working protection dogs, because business insurance, home insurance, those are the two things that you should have. But know that if your dog gets a bite, no matter what, especially in LA, knowing that LA County Animal Control is the most corrupt organization I've ever dealt with. And I've done business in Belarus. I've done business in Belarus, and they are still the most corrupt organization I've ever dealt with. You're going to have your dog confiscated. You're looking at quarantine, which is between $15 and $30 a day. And you have the potential label that's going to come back: dangerous dog, vicious dog, which what that means in real terms is, especially in LA County, your dog could have to be muzzled for the rest of his life, including in your backyard. That could mean anytime you are more than 6 feet away from your home, you may need a muzzle. That may mean your dog can't actually leave your home, right? So when you get down into the nitty gritty and you start looking at these penal codes, it's important to know what it means for where you live. And living in a place like LA County is just not a conducive place to owning a protection dog, especially if you're a person of color.
Right. So let me say this. So like I said, I do a lot of... I film a lot of protection sports stuff, and I don't want to. I know I've been in the comment section with several people this week, or maybe one or two people, and they're like, you know, they're kind of thinking I'm kind of down on the concept of dogs biting. I just think that, like, again, like I said, it's a big spectrum of possibilities when you have a dog bite. You as a grown up should think about the probability, the liability, and all of those things before you start working on that. But the one thing I will say, for me personally, we did a series earlier this year with women training dogs. And I will say this, one of the most valuable things I see in protection training, well, the relationship between man and beast, woman and beast, is second to none. Your communication skills and your understanding of one another becomes way higher than just pet ownership. So I think there's value in that. I also think that a lot of people, and I will say this, the women specifically that I've seen doing protection training, have a different level of confidence and move differently, understanding that they have done what they've done with this dog.
This dog.
Here we go again.
Here we go again.
I'm about to say goodbye to you.
I'm about to say goodbye to you.
I don't know why it keeps popping in like that. Let me just start it over again. Call me back real quick.
Call me back.
Damn. Oh, oops. Excuse my language. I hung up on here, but I thought I deaded the show. I was about to start cussing because it's kind of upsetting. So we're going to wait for him to call me back. And then he called me back. Perfect. Boom. There we go. All right. Perfect. So speak on that. And even with men, I know a lot of people, they're passionate about this protection training. It transforms them as individuals. It's an amazing hobby. It's an amazing extracurricular activity. It's an amazing sport. And for some of you guys, it's a lifestyle.
Right, right. And I appreciate it. I love it. And let me be clear, from a scientific standpoint, controlled aggression is inevitable, right? Dogs speak fluent violence. So I'm not somebody sitting here like my fur babies and, you know, doing that kind of thing. I respect that. It's your dog. Do whatever you want. But for me, you know, and all of you have seen it at some point, put two puppies down next to a bowl of food or two strangers. two stranger dogs next to a bowl of water, and you will learn right at that moment. Dogs speak fluent violence. What we do as trainers is try to take that and basically put it on cue, right? We got a dog that's yapping, rah, rah, rah. We teach the dog quiet, and then we put the bark on command so that we can control the situation a little better. It's the same thing with dogs biting. Dogs are going to bite, period. We're just trying to be somewhat in control of when and where it happens. And I'm perfectly fine with that. I think with women, because my first major protection project was a woman who contacted me with a restraining order, an open restraining order, and she needed her dog to both alert her when this guy was around and then potentially engage this guy. And I had no idea what I was doing at that point. So I basically reverse engineered, you know, I had a whole like Venn diagram up on my wall, and we used his clothes, and I used some things, you know, to kind of give the dog an idea of who we were thinking about. And for her, it was a very serious thing. It wasn't a sport. And the guys that I train with, in particular, the guys that I learned a bunch of protection stuff from in Compton, these guys are serious dudes with serious dogs. And when you think about what life in Compton has meant for the last 20 years, it makes sense. And for me, I didn't quite understand it initially. But when you think about somebody who maybe is incarcerated and gets out and can't have a firearm, but is released back into the environment where they got locked up with people who may not necessarily appreciate the fact that they're still drawing breath on the earth, you need something serious. So I was fortunate in that my introduction to the protection world was some of the most serious dogs in LA. You got to think, the first four dogs I caught in LA ever was White Boy, Pile Driver, Mongol, and Rico. Those were my first four catches ever. And every single one of those dogs are serious and will really, really lay you down.
Right.
I didn't even realize there were sport dogs who didn't want to really bite me until I kind of made my way into the protection sport world. You know, I'm out there gearing up. I got on like anti-cut gloves for my hands, and you know, there's sport people looking at me like, what is wrong with you? I'm like, I'm not trying to get tore up. And they're like, oh, you don't have to worry about that. And I'm like, no, I do. Right. So I get it and I appreciate it. And I think for women, especially women, it can be an essential tool for their lives. And that's kind of why we launched our Women in Protection group, is for the women who want to learn, want that bond with their dogs, maybe need that kind of energy from their dogs, but don't necessarily feel comfortable in kind of the general training setting with men there and this kind of thing. So these women come out and they support each other and they work dogs and they're comfortable making mistakes around each other. But for them, it's serious, because, you know, a crime of opportunity is more likely to happen to a woman. It may be you walking in your house and somebody sees you, or you walk into your car and it's late at night. You know, you want to be able to have that kind of relationship. But the way we teach it is functionally geared towards their lifestyle. You know, it's not like a one size fits all kind of a thing.
Right.
My experience has been that women in dangerous situations like that aren't thinking Stalin or whatever their bite word is, right? So we train things like grabbing the collar as a turn up command, right? Or help as a potential bite command. Because in my experience, and we run experiments all day, 87% of the women that we tested could not remember their bite word in crunch time situation. All of them remembered help. So when we train their dogs, they have a bite word. They also has help as the secondary word, because we know they're going to forget the bite word.
Right.
Things like that have been helpful for us, and I think helpful for them. And they all have said the same exact thing. It's given them a certain kind of confidence, a certain kind of independence, where they can now leave the house and feel comfortable that they're going to make it home unscathed.
Right, right. Well, listen, so in helping people, we have this technology, now hopefully it works out perfectly. I don't know, it's been acting funny right tonight. If you guys are out there, you want to call in, you have a question, I'll probably take 4 or 5 calls. It's about 10 minutes to 8 here, so it's 10 minutes to 11 where John is at. So if you guys want to call in, there's a link in the description. Click the link, you can call in, you can ask John your question. But speak to the passion of it. Speak to, okay, no, let's do this. Man, speak to the passion of it then. Go ahead.
I love it so much. I think taking a dog from, and I guess my beginning was different, right? Like Crixus was my first protection dog and he didn't have particularly a pronounced drive, zero aggression, zero ball drive. Like, so for me, I began my career in protection work solving problems. I didn't get to take advantage or take credit for genetics that were already there. So for me, watching a dog kind of find his or her own, figure out that communication dynamic with the handler, and then develop the confidence to, in its mind, think, my owner is bothered by what you're doing right now. So I'm going to give you the opportunity to walk away. And then if you don't walk away, I'm going to punish you with violence. I think from a scientific standpoint, that perspective is just fascinating to me because each dog has its own version of that and their own expression and then their own kind of engagement and then their own kind of disengagement. And for me, it's just been interesting to watch these dogs go from some of them from puppies into full-fledged protection dogs and the police dogs and the military dogs. And then some of them like wild animals. Some of the dogs we get from overseas are basically wild animals. So to watch them go from wild animals to kind of these semi-domesticated cohabitants and partners with these people is awesome. So for me, the passion of it is more on understanding how the dog thinks relative to these, even in terms of building a threat profile. How you build a threat profile for a Malinois is going to be different than how you build it for a German Shepherd versus how you build it for a Kangal or a Corso. And people who don't understand that will try to train a Corso the way you would train a Malinois. Well, one is a livestock guardian, so their threat profile is completely different. One is a herder that's, you know, kind of activated by motion. So for me, getting into it and traveling the world and seeing how every culture kind of has their version of this and like what's a priority for them. When I was in Vietnam, targeting isn't necessarily a priority in Vietnamese protection work. Whereas but the recall is. Here in America, we put a lot of emphasis on targeting and the grip and all of these kinds of goofy things that really don't matter. I think people who maybe never been bitten by a dog came up with a lot of this goofiness. But then when I got deeper into it and I had to go to court and explain what happened, thank God I'm so thorough in my notes, but I'm like, look, my dog has had exactly, you know, 117 hours of this work. These are the seven areas I picked for targeting. These are the reasons I picked these areas for targeting. And this is why he hit that particular place. And I was able to give that to the DA and they were looking at it like, well, damn. So like, it's just been fascinating. France, they don't really like civil dogs in France. You know, they call them out of control and they send them to America. So being in France and watching certain dogs work and thinking about how we train in America, these dogs would never fly in France. Nobody wants that dog in France.
Right.
Nobody. Right. Same dog that goes here for 70 grand, you couldn't give away for free in France because they just don't have a need for it. Their police pride themselves on not having like to deploy their dogs on the civilian population. So I kind of dug that. I think that to me is where my passion is. It's not so much in like the bitey bites, but in everything leading up to it.
Okay. Well, we got some callers. We got Anthony. He's waiting in the green room. I'm going to bring him in.
Hey, how's it going?
Wonderful.
Hey.
Thanks. Nice thanks for your time. I appreciate it. I just had a kind of a quick question as far as your training, right? Do you implement your family into the training as well?
Yeah, absolutely. I think one of my early experiences was, I won't say his name because he might be watching, a police officer who had a dog, and this dog was a savage. I mean, like a real savage. The issue that he ran into is they taught this particular dog to respond to pain with aggression. So that could be the vet tech giving him his lepto vaccine.
That's a bad
in his situation though. It was his daughter walking to the kitchen to get cookies and milk in the middle of the night, stepped on the dog's tail and got lit up.
Ooh.
So we are trying to work towards a more neutral response to everything unless instructed. A dog that can trust the handler completely and can say, look, you're going to let me know when there's a problem. And then if I think there's a problem, I'm going to let you know before I make a decision. So for true protection dogs, should be transferable to your family. Otherwise, they are your protection dog and your family's liability, in my opinion.
I kind of like what you said earlier. You know, lots of people think they want protection dogs when truly what they want is like an alert watchdog, you right. know. So, I don't know. I've been waiting for 9 months and I'm 6 more months out for my Kanai course. So, and I have a trainer. I mean, I'm just ordered the kennel. It's been a long time in the making. I know exactly what I want. And I'm just kind of, my concern is if I'm the only one doing the training with my pup, if I'm not here, I'm at work, right? How's it going to go for my family or my kiddos? So right. that's why I called in. And just again, thank you guys for your time.
Yeah, that's all a legitimate right. concern.
Sorry, Anthony. Thanks.
You should express that concern to your trainer. The Corso is an amazing breed. There's a man named James Daly in LA, has one of the baddest Corsos I've seen, named Harley. I love that dog to death. And I made the mistake. I trained Harley. And I made the mistake one day. I was trying to scoot behind her. She was on the tie out and she turned around and lit me up, live bite. And it was like almost a penis bite. Like it was crazy. And she's on the bite and her owner, Tina, was like, ah, and I'm like, nope. She did the right thing. I shouldn't have been creeping behind her. So then they outed her and she outed and I'm bleeding through my pants. It was terrible. But like, you know, they would both, they take turns handling the dog. And I think this is important. And I think you want to make sure your trainer understands the Corso, both historically, genetically, anatomically, because all that should inform the training. If they try to train your Corso like a Malinois, which is pretty much the standard right now, you're going to end up with a so-so, you're going to end up with a terrible Malinois and like a so-so Corso. You know, the livestock guardians are different. The threat profile is different. The way they bite is different. The way they engage is different. So you'll want to factor all that in and then have your family there with you watching. The chances of your dog, you know, your kids being out in the street and needing to deploy the dog are minimal, but you want the dog to at least understand that these people are important to you and that if they give instructions, they should be followed. I think that part gets left out a lot. So that shows, you know, you got a lot of brains to be thinking about that. And like, you're going to be a responsible owner, which, you know, shout out your community. Thanks you in advance.
So real quick, do you want the, if you're training your dog, do you want to bring your family to the training or do you want to, when you get home, teach your dog what you learn?
It could go either way. If you're the kind of person who does your homework and you're engaged in that way, I think you can kind of show your family. And it really kind of depends on the training scenario. Not all training situations are safe for families. For us, we have defined areas. Everybody wears an orange vest to let us know who's demarked to be on the field and not on the field. So our training situations, I urge people to bring their family because I think it's important. Usually, my experience so far has been that in a relationship, one person is very excited for the protection dog and one person is not. So I think it can also help that transition of bringing a new dog into the home with these enhanced capabilities. And my experience has been that the kids tend to love it, but the kids are so far down on the pecking order that dogs don't always respond to the kids in the same way they do to the primary and secondary handlers. So I generally, like my kids will be at the trainings because I'm going to need them to understand how to utilize this tool. And I'm gonna need the tool to understand, you know, the dog to understand that these kids are very important to me. So we've worked like object guards with strollers. There's a girl named Leslie in LA with a great dog named Dexter. We've worked a bunch of object guards with her on the stroller and, you know, started kind of rocky, but towards the end, like Dexter's with the whole business. You go after okay. that stroller, getting bit.
Okay. I got another guy. I believe next on the list is going to be Big Rich. My man, what's going on with you?
What's up, man? What's up, G-Ball? Good. Hey, I like what the bro is saying. Mostly what he's saying is he's imprinting the behavior that he wants to see in the dog. And a lot of people don't know about imprinting behaviors. They get a dog, but my question to him, and it's not really to him, it's for him to like expand on it. So these dudes who don't know about imprinting, the behavior on a working dog, what would you suggest for a young person who's starting to get a dog and want to learn about protection dog? What would you suggest a good route for them to start imprinting?
I would say, this is going to sound crazy, but if you're getting a protection dog and you want to set yourself up for success as well as the dog, I would say watch everything on YouTube you can on how to play with your dog and how to engage your dog. If you can do those things, if you can walk around your house, your yard, and your dog be attached to you, then you have done things right in terms of your imprinting, and you should probably take that step and start working on protection if that's your end goal. You know, most of the people that I encounter don't know how to play with their dogs. And I mean tugs and balls and, you know, these kinds of things. Part of my imprinting process, and people who work with me will tell you, my dogs don't eat out of a dog bowl until about a year old. My dogs eat out of my hand every single night until they're about a year old. And what I found is that it creates a different kind of understanding, a different kind of relationship. Even the dogs that I don't work in protection, the dogs that I own that I don't work in protection, understand the plug. They understand where the food's coming from, and they're going to turn up the same way my protection dogs will, because they've eaten out of my hands every single meal. You got, depending on the breed, between, let's say, 8 and 14 years to feed the dog out of the bowl. Take advantage of that first year. Feed that dog out of your hand. If you've got kids, let the kids feed the dog out of your hand. Let your wife, or if you're a wife, let the husband, or if you live with your mother, whatever it is, everybody should be accustomed to kind of engaging this dog, and the dog should be accustomed and understand everything good in my life comes from my humans. We are in this together. But what I see mostly is dogs that basically live with a roommate that tells them what to do all the time. And you can kind of see the expression on the field. So imprinting could be anything. I mean, we start puppies at a very young age. We walk them outside. We count down from 15, 15, 14. They don't know what the hell's going on. By the time they go to the bathroom, you know, maybe we've counted down from 15, 5 different times. But they go, we click it, and then we treat, treat, treat. So by the time these dogs are 8 weeks old, 10 weeks old, we walk outside, 15, 14, and they're going to the bathroom as quick as they can, staring at you, and then sprinting back to get their treat. What I found is that's useful for me. Having just made a week drive from LA to Atlanta, all of my dogs being on a timer to go to the bathroom made life substantially easier. So little things like that, don't let trainers kind of dictate to you what you need. You figure out what you need, and then you go to your trainer. I need my dog to go to the bathroom on command. I need my dog to go to the bed whenever I tell him to. I need my, whatever it is for you, and build that into your imprinting, because it's going to make training substantially easier later down the line.
I agree with you, brother. Everything you're saying is on point. I just wanted the new people who don't know nothing about what you talk, really talking about with protection dogs, to understand. Also, socialization is a key. And when you hand feeding the dog, you also building that bond and letting them know you the alpha and you the master. You can trust me when you hand feed. Right. I used to do that with my protection dogs too. You in Atlanta now, man, is a old time dog trainer out there, man, from LA. You might know him if you grew up in the LA area. K9, Larry Hill from K9 yeah, Thrills.
Larry Hill. Larry knows me. I know Larry.
Yeah, I remember you. I think you used to hang out with the Black Stallions back in a little while ago.
I know him. Sure. I know Larry for sure. Larry's a good dog trainer. He's one of the first guys I started watching on YouTube when I was first trying to like learn what all of this meant. I was watching Larry Hill's channel, Malcolm Lazenby,
OJ them all old Black Stallions, all yeah. old Black Stallions, and
Donnell Sykes, yeah, a lot of those guys.
Yeah, all right. I remember you. I remember seeing your face around. But we never really connected, bro. But I'm glad to see you doing what you still doing, bro, and the passion that you love. And Z-Ball, man, you know I'm proud of you, brother, and love you, man, for everything you do to educate these people in this world, man. I got a link to this, and it said live. I said, I got to go see my homie and tell him what's up, man. That's what's up.
Thanks so much, bro.
Next time I'm in LA, bro, I got to take you to lunch, bro.
All right, we'll do that.
All right, bro, y'all peace out, man. And keep grinding, brother, what you doing, King.
All right, man. Thanks so much.
I'm fortunate that I work with a lot of the legends in the game. Definitely fortunate to have worked with so many amazing trainers and been able to, like he said, I usually am in the background taking notes, trying to figure out what's going on. So that's cool.
Yeah, that's Big Rich. He goes back. He goes back way, way, way back. He looked like he lost some weight though, so I didn't really recognize him. But I know when he said Z-Ball, that's only one person called me Z-Ball. So that's what's up. Let me get Jason in here real quick. How's it going, my brother?
75
I can't hear you. What is that?
I don't know.
Hello.
Hey, Jason, yeah, what's going on with you, bro?
Hey, how you doing? John, how you doing, sir?
Hey.
Hello, John.
Nice to meet you.
Hello.
Yeah, I think we got a little delay with you, bro. Let me see what's going on here.
Hey, how you doing? How you doing? Thanks for having me.
All right, great. Can you...
Hey, John, I got a question for you, man. Okay. Nice to meet you. Was a delay.
Just ask your question, brother.
It's my dream to do what you do. Dogs is my passion, and that's how can I get with your team?
Oh, man, send us an email. You can go to the website or social media, send us an email. You know, all I'm really doing is kind of like being open to opportunities. You know, like I got pulled into a project today that is an all-male wolf sanctuary where they're having issues establishing a pecking order, an alpha in an all-male wolf sanctuary. Quite certain out to me, but I think it's cool and I'm gonna do it. So like, you know, just send us an email, but these things, you know, I'm just trying to be open. I think the less dogmatic you are in this dog world, the more opportunities come to you. And like, you ask a million people how to, you know, do something like drywalling or, you know, like, there's going to be kind of a foundation, but everybody's going to have their way. You ask people how do you cook tiramisu, like how do you make tiramisu cake, and there's going to be a million different recipes. I think being open to it and not being this is the only way to do it will open up opportunities, because I've worked with positive reinforcement trainers, I've worked with peer compulsion people, you know, I've worked with all kinds of interesting situations. And I think being open to it, you want to be true to who you are, so there are situations I won't engage, but being open to it and being willing to learn how someone else does it so that you can add that tool to your toolbox, I found people tend to respond very well to that.
All right, cool. So but basically, if you want to get in touch with John, just your email, what's your email address?
You can do contact@redemptionroadk9.com. That'll come and we'll get that right away. You know, some of the other stuff like Instagram, people spam and weird stuff. But if you email that...
And he's in Atlanta. John is the facility's not exactly in Atlanta, but that's the closest airport, right?
Yeah. I'm about 15 minutes outside Atlanta.
Okay, there you go. Yeah, there you go. All right, Jason. Thank you, bro. Take it easy. All right, we got one more person. My man Eves right here. Oh, we got another call just came in from Phil. We're going to take Eves real quick.
Hey, guys. How's it going,
my man?
Hey.
Wonderful. How you doing?
Cool. Calling in from Brooklyn, New York. How you guys doing?
Brooklyn? Yeah. What part of Brooklyn? Hold on. What part of Brooklyn?
Flatbush.
Okay. I live in Bed-Stuy. 150 Monroe. Between Nostrand and Bed-Stuy.
That's crazy. I raised my Doberman in Bed-Stuy. So he's real socialized with them dog-friendly whites over there. Them gentrified. But he loves people.
When I was there, wasn't no dog-friendly white people. That's back in like 1997. Go ahead.
Yeah, a lot of things don't change. So I've always loved dogs, right? Always, always, always. Like I'm Haitian. I'm from a Haitian background. I came here when I was like 1 year old, you know what I'm saying? And you know, people from the Caribbean can be a little ignorant when it comes to the dog thing. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Because they're used to letting the dog run around and they don't, you know,
right.
They don't take care of them dogs. And when them dogs pack up and become wild dogs. They call them mongrels and all that. But me, I just always had an affinity for dogs. I met this girl in Bed-Stuy, and she had a Shiba Inu. And I don't know if you guys ever worked with those type of dogs. But from what I...
They're very challenging dogs.
Personality, but this one is probably like on the sweeter end. This one is a very special individual. I would not get a Shiba Inu unless I was guaranteed that this it would have her personality. But anyways, helping my that's my Dobie. Leave it. Go to your place. Send him to place. Training that dog with her showed me a lot, and it made me realize, hey, I want a dog, but I do not want a Shiba. I want a dog that actually listens. So I got a Doberman, and I had a lot of resources growing up. One of my neighbors was like, works for the AKC as an evaluator, and he gave me a lot of tips with the hand feeding and all of that. But I'm not too sure what direction I want him to go to the next level, because I feel like he has potential to do things, but it's just like I don't know what direction to go, and I don't want to keep constantly, you know, relying on dog trainers. You know what I'm saying? Because I've been doing most of it myself. But I had to bring in some professional help, you know, for certain things, because he got attacked by a pit bull when he was a pup, and I had to re-socialize him, and I couldn't do it myself. The anxiety was crazy. But he's becoming very neutral, you know? He started off very submissive, but he's becoming very neutral. And I really don't know, like what I want to do with him. At first, when I got it over, and I'm thinking, oh, maybe I might do IPO, shih tzu, and all of that. But as I got deeper into it, I'm just like, maybe this dude is not cut out for this. Or do I have to that out of him?
I think it could go either way. The Doberman is such a nuanced breed. Mm-hmm. I have a half Doberman. I actually just came from working some Dobermans tonight, though. My boy Isaiah over in Fayetteville got some pretty serious Dobermans. We did some home defense with his stuff tonight. But what I will say is the Doberman is a very sensitive dog. So you got to be mindful.
A very what sensitive? I didn't hear that part.
Handler sensitive. The dog is going to be very you handler, like owner sensitive.
Yes. Okay. Very sensitive. I believe that.
So you got to be mindful how you correct them and when and in what way. But and then you want to really kind of think about the Doberman's anatomy. That's going to inform the training. These are the things that keep me up at night. So maybe people don't think about these, but you think about the Doberman as opposed to the Malinois. The Malinois is a shorter neck, more narrow head in terms of swiveling. So when you think about how Malinois bites, they're coming in and it's much easier for them to turn their heads. Doberman, because of that long neck, it can be a little painful for them. So if you watch a Doberman bite, you're going to see them come up. That's why they're like ass biters, right?
Yeah, I see. Like they reach up. They reach up and grab. So
you can enhance that, right? With that's already there, you can try to force them to be a shepherd of some sort and then kind of have a shitty shepherd and a weird Doberman. So I think it's possible. The dog doesn't need to be ferocious to do well in protection sports. It can be a choreographed dance. If you don't need a dog that's, you know, energized like that, then don't even worry about it. Just go out, you know, and like I know a trainer in LA who I think it was a Labrador. He put a title on a Labrador, and he gave me so much game. But what he said is, we taught this dog to bite as a retrieve.
Yeah.
Think about what I'm saying, right? Rather than the dog thinking I'm going to fight a man, you know, they started with a tug. They had the dog go bite the tug and bring it back. Then they moved to a sleeve. Then they moved to the sleeve on the man. So the dog runs out, bites the sleeve, pulls it, and then brings it back. So they taught this Labrador how to bite.
To rip off a man's arm and bring it back to you?
No.
I'm playing.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
I get it. To retrieve.
If you look at it as a training challenge and an opportunity for you to gain more clarity with your dog, then you won't be frustrated. You won't be as disappointed. And you'll actually kind of probably pioneer a completely new way to train protection. And that's kind of what we do, is try to figure out and train the dog in front of us rather than hold them to some standard that someone else made. We try to train the dog in front of us. And like with Crixus, he's not a slow dog, but he has a slow entry. So what I did to make up a slow entry is I gave him as much jaw strength as I could give him. It also ended up working out for me because it is virtually impossible to esquive that dog. You're not going to esquive Crixus. Now a bunch of people like, oh, he said that about to keep that motherfucking down, right? So, but like, because he's coming in slow, it's going to be more challenging for you to esquive him, and he's putting everything he has into his bite. The people who've taken bites from him are like, yeah, that dog really bites. But I had to get a powerful bite because he's never going to be a Dutch or a Malinois jumping and launching with all the acrobatics. He's much too intellectual for that. He comes in and he's looking at what you're doing, and he's like, all right, cool. Ha! And I just chose rather than force
him. You work on his strength. You work on his strength. Don't force him to do anything awkward.
Right. So basically what he's telling you is, with your dog specifically, don't get rid of all your pre-assumptions about what a dog should do and how they should do it. Figure out what motivates your dog, how your dog works, how to best maximize and accentuate his talents. And what you'll do is you'll like you said, you'll become a very unique person, a new unique trainer, and working with this specific type of Doberman. I mean, obviously, there's a spectrum on Dobermans, and not all. Some of them are more.
I'm not gonna lie, he's very chill. A lot of people say I got a chill Doberman pup. He is naturally protected.
How old is he?
He's 8 months, about to be 9 months.
He's still young, he ain't even who he is. Yeah, he's a young dog, dude.
He's just a pup. You know what I'm saying?
But I don't know, listen, right? Yeah, you know, look, my son
but
is.
But I want a direction. You know what I'm saying? And my mentor told me I should at least try to.
A lot of people gonna find this controversial, but I learned a lot of game from my time in LA, and I think. The dogs on the fence and work their drive. We'll build the drive up to where we don't have to worry about whether or not they want to bite. And by that, you know, kind of restrained drive building creates a frustration. That frustration kind of is a self-fulfilling prophecy. It's a snowball effect. They end up so frustrated. By the time they do get to bite something, they're putting everything into it and biting as hard as they can. I know a lot of fancy dogs don't do this, right? I'm in those circles too. Tying out a dog is considered lowly for a lot of people. I get it. But if your goal is to bring out the aggression in your dog, what I personally did was I looked at the yard I was on, I picked the two most serious dogs I could, and at that time it was Pile Driver, who's owned by Lee Sanders, and Mongol by South Bay Malinois, and I put Crixus in between them for about a year straight. So on on repeat every day, he's watching these two serious ass dogs beat the man. He's kind of learning what the game is, and like,
and he's falling in line.
Yeah, he's a a good dog now.
But your dog is young though, so let's
he's young.
Yeah, so when does he need to start really concerning himself? Because this dog ain't even hit like.
No, I mean, I would say now, like, you get him on the fence now, you know, you start working on that drive now, I think you'll see the difference right away, you know?
Yeah. My mentor and the trainer I brought in to work his trauma and resocialization, they told me one place I could start is getting him CGC certified, because he's pretty good with the basic obedience. I think I might want to turn it up with the advanced. The natural protectiveness doesn't come out unless it needs to. Like, he really is, I've exposed him to a lot. Like, it really takes an unusual situation, like being outside at 3 a.m. and a crackhead running at me for him to turn up. After that, he doesn't really care about people at all. Like, he kind of is used to, you know, I take this nigga out every day. I'm not going to lie to you. Like, I got him after I got in an accident, and I just been working him. But I'm just like, I don't know where I want to go after the CGC thing. However, y'all feel about CGC.
Hold on one second. I'm looking at John. He's frozen. He's frozen in a very funny way.
I thought he was listening very well.
He's frozen. he's calling it. It's funny. Oh, excuse my language, bro. Let me do this real quick. Oh my God, that was funny. Let's see. There you go. Hold on, let me bring him in real quick. Hey, Eves, hold on, John, real quick. Hey, Eves, I'm gonna let you go, man. I got one more call, and I got to get out of here. It's 8:20. But thanks a lot. Yeah. Right, I have an extra question.
What would y'all recommend though? Like, from y'all point.
CGC is a great place to start. I mean, obedience is always the way you want to start with the any kind of dog, you know. So, and he's 8 months old. So get his obedience solid, see where he is, see how he matures as he gets older, as his testosterone starts to pump. You can definitely work on the aggression, frustration.
Yeah. We keeping the balls for sure.
Yeah. So, you know, good luck with that. Let me get to my man Phil, and I'm gonna get up out of here.
All right. Thanks, James. I appreciate you, bro.
Take it easy. Wait, one more call, John. Just give me 1 second.
Let's see. Yeah, no problem.
Oh, I think I just lost Phil. Phil, call back. I'm sorry, bro. I think I just hung up on you. There you go. Perfect. All right. There we go. Boom. My man.
Hey, what's going on, my guys?
Good, man.
Hey. What's up, man? Thank y'all for being on the call. This is my first time being on the live stream with y'all, man. I appreciate what y'all doing, dropping the jewels for the people.
Yes, sir.
That's a sub. I get right to it. So currently, I'm waiting on the litter. 2 pit bull terriers, me and my lady, waiting on the litter. They're Bourgeois Eli. And I guess I wanted more so advice than I had a question. So I kind of want the dog to be like me in a sense, athletic and articulate. I don't really have any plans on it being a strictly guard dog or a strictly, guard dog. So what advice would you give for someone wanting their dog to be about 80-90% of an athlete, just a pure athletic dog that's intelligent, that's smart?
Okay. That's a good question. I'm obsessed with this, right? That's actually my preferred space, is kind of the fitness, conditioning, and detection. Those are my 3 areas of expertise, right? So one, I would say take your time. With the pit bull terriers, you're not going to need to do a ton early on. This is going to be controversial, what I'm about to say next, but I believe in it. And I can show you the paperwork. My German Shepherd just got his OFAs back. Excellent hips, elbows, knees, eyes, heart. Same with my Malinois, same with my Kangal. I start my dogs on a glucosamine at about 12 weeks old. I don't use dog glucosamine, though. I use glucosamine for a horse. I can tell you what the brand is. I cannot prescribe anything for you. I start vet school very soon, but I am not a vet yet. So take the information I'm giving you and please run it by your vet, and maybe take it to 3 vets and then, you know, kind of take the average. But I use Animed 5000. If you look it up on Amazon, Animed 5000, it's a horse glucosamine. It comes with multiple, like a double scooper in it. I use the smaller scoop for my dogs. I also do omega oils. So I'm really kind of preparing the dog. And if you think about it, like if you were preparing a human to be an elite athlete, you would do things like help the kid understand that exercise is a good thing. This is how you bond with dad, right? People who you think about Kobe Bryant, or you think about Tiger Woods or Serena, any of these people, they learn to love their sport via their parent and then found their own passion for it. So I would give them very controlled exercise, fitness, and conditioning, low impact. Don't be the guy that has his dog at doing 2 mile runs at 8 weeks. Don't be that guy. That's a dog that's going to burn out and have a ton of health issues later. But you can do things like, after they're vaccinated, walking through the sand. Just walking through the sand is going to be a great workout, right? I will introduce puppy agility. And by puppy agility, that is no more than 3 or 4 inches off the ground. But I'll have them walking over things, going through cans, walking over grates. I'm so anal about my particular training program that a lot of the things that hinder a dog from reaching their athletic potential, his or her athletic potential, are environmental issues. So every night when we feed here, I have a different sound playing in the kennel. I'm giving you the sauce right now. Nobody even knows this. Okay. I'll have babies crying through my loudspeakers in the kennels, so that my dogs eat with babies crying, they eat with construction sounds, they eat with gunshots, they eat with fireworks, pick the sound, and my dogs have eaten with it. So by the time they're 8 months old, 9 months old, 10 months old, a year, a baby crying, a gunshot doesn't mean anything. We actually, I can't speak on that, but we had a scenario recently where there was a ton of gunfire. My dogs were legit chill. One of them even came and like laid down. That's what gunshots mean to my dogs at this point, is nothing, which is what I want. So preparing them in that way, I say you can do a ton of aquatic work. If you have a pool or you have access to a pool, go to like TJ Maxx or Kohl's or Ross Dress for Less. They sell these kind of discounted doggy life vests. They're perfectly fine, but it's like Finding Nemo or some goofy, right? I did that. I bought 7 Finding Nemo life jackets for my dogs and had them all in the pool. And I got from like puppy all the way to extra large. So I got my dogs learning how to swim as puppies with the life jacket on in a controlled environment. That's before I ever take them to the ocean. I'm going to make sure they're getting all of the food they need, all the nutrients they need. And then I'm going to go a little bit more. So we blend the food down to powder. And then I hydrate the powder with the dog's daily needs in terms of water. What I found is that when the dog goes from 20% absorption to about 60-70% absorption. So I found that their coats look different, their teeth look different. I'm adding, I'm doing like Dical for calcium. I'm doing Nupro. I love Nupro as a multi. I'm doing fish oil. I'm doing goat's milk. I might do goat's cheese. And then my Sundays, we call them cancer fighting days. So on Sundays, I'm blending up kale, spinach, blueberries, raspberries, strawberries. What else we do? Cucumbers, kind of stuff. I blend it up and turn it into a puree and mix it into the powdered kibble and then hydrate it with goat's milk. And we call that superfood. And that's my cancer fighting Sundays because I got a Rottie. And Rotties don't just die of like one cancer. They die of 100 cancers, right? I want to try to reduce the chances of that for my particular Rottweiler and the other dogs that I have. So we do that every Sunday. What I found is that kind of a program, by the time these dogs hit 8-9 months where you can now actually work them out, they're ready to go. They're not even thinking about it. Try to identify whatever makes the dog nervous. That could be linoleum floors. That could be see-through stairs. I mean, really anything. I do it all. But, you know, figure out what makes your dog nervous and then make that a strength. So I have a dog that was weird about see-through stairs. I went to, like, Lowe's and bought one of those kind of, like, you know, little stair climber. You know what I mean? Like, I bought one of those for $150 and made the dog eat his meal every night on a step. And I would go from the bottom step. And then I went to the second step, got to the point where the dog had to climb all the way up to eat his meal at the top and then come back down. So now, and then you know the dog is Crixus. So when we got to America's Top Dog and they're like, yo, can your dog scale this and run across this bridge? I was like, go. And he hit it. You got to remember on the show, I lost 90 seconds on the ball pull and still finished first that round because when it came time for my boy to hit the jumps and run across the bridge, he finished like 60 seconds faster than every other dog. And it was from all the work we had done as a puppy. And then when your dog is of age, you can do things like short drags. I do a ton of work in the sand. I love sand works. I got different tires for different breeds. So my Malinois pull a Honda Civic tire. My German Shepherd pulls a Cadillac tire. And my Kangals pull Dodge Ram tires. Right. So like just little things like that. But just take it slow. And if you have questions about it, contact your vet. And make sure that, you know, you're asking. But there's a ton of information online, and there's people who do this. Dr. Erica Bowling, she runs a program. Do you know Dr. Erica Bowling? She runs Northeast Canine Conditioning. Please look her up. Erica Bowling, E-R-I-C-A-B-O-L-I-N-G. She's a genius. Okay. If you do what she does, you will have probably the best conditioned dog in your city. And she teaches a course. And she, you know, you can sign up for her course and take it, and, you know, it'll change your life.
Cool, man. I appreciate that. And, of course, all that athletic work accompanied with obedience training and, you know, basic obedience training. Have you found that the competence and intelligence is still there minus the killer aggression that.
You know, my dogs start obedience early, but they don't know they're doing obedience. They just think we're hanging out. So I'm using treats and I'm using toys, but they don't know it. But, you know, I might ask to sit and they sit and boom. Yes. Now we're playing with the ball, or, you know, I play with their minds. So like my female Anatolian today, we went to the gas station and sit and she sat and I like jackpotted her with some steak. And I did that early, like 7 a.m. So for the whole rest of the day, every command down, boom. You know what I mean? Like, I just play with lines like that. We do these, we call them happy visits to the vet, where On the way to the vet, I take the dog to In-N-Out or, you know, McDonald's, whatever, and get a Scooby snack. You can order it at 70 cents for a patty. They don't put no salt on it. And then we go to the vet, and I got all the vet techs treating, and then we leave. And then, you know, and I'm putting this on verbal cue. You ready to go to the vet? And we go and get a Scooby snack. Then we go do the vet thing. They get treats there. Then we leave, and then we get another Scooby snack on the way home. To me, is it obedience? Kinda. Is it management? Probably more management than obedience. But I found the better I am at the imprinting stage in terms of management, the easier obedience is. So I don't really ever have to fight with my dogs for obedience. Like, if you look at my dogs or you talk to anybody who knows my dogs, they will find a toy somewhere in the world randomly and bring it back and slam it into me like, time to work. And they're telling me it's time to work. And like, mm-hmm. that's what you want, is an active dog who sees you as an ATM machine or a vending machine full of goodies that they're trying to get from you through obedience. Then you never have to fight about obedience.
Man, that's solid. I appreciate it, man. Thank y'all, yeah. gentlemen.
All right, thank you, Phil. Exactly. Appreciate you calling in, bro. Man, have a great evening. All right,
y'all take it easy, man. Thank you.
All right,
just
thanks for calling
say.
In.
Thanks a lot, yes, man. Sir. All right, my man, you did a wonderful job, man. As
thank
I knew you
for
would.
Having me.
I appreciate
Thank
you,
you
man.
For having me.
We might need to do this every so often. You know what I'm saying? Because there's so much that you know about, and we didn't even really, you know, we touched on like a slither of what you do and what you know about, and you know, because you're working it every day. So I'm gonna probably call upon you again. Typically, I'm cued by some comment or some interest that's left in the comment section, and then I'll come back to you and say, can we do this again? I think one of the things that we probably should already have in the queue is, let's talk about women in training, because we already have those women in training videos. So
right,
just
right.
talk to that. Maybe we could bring Sharon in on that as well.
Yeah, she's in it. You know, there's a woman, Hasha. She got, you know, two great Dobermans, and she got yeah. a new Mal. We got Melissa. I mean, we got a ton of women, and they're yeah. all with it.
Or maybe
you know,
I can
we love documentary.
Yeah, maybe I could do a round table with the ladies. Were you sitting there, just put three of the ladies?
That'd be amazing.
That'd be dope. Yeah.
You let me know. We'll set it up. We'll set
right,
it up,
do
bro.
That.
You're going to go
next.
Down, bro.
That's what's up.
You're going to go down in the Dog Hall of Fame for all this work you're doing.
I hope so, man. I hope so. I hope so.
Will, bro. We'll make sure of it.
All right, man. Well, I appreciate you, man. You know, as always, you're more than gracious with your time. I definitely appreciate your energy. I love seeing young brothers become masters, you know, and that's what you're doing with the dog thing. I really appreciate that.
Appreciate it.
And I appreciate you sharing that with the audience. Guys, if you haven't already, you can follow John on at Redemption Road K9 on Instagram. I think all your handles are just at Redemption Road K9, right? K.
Yep, absolutely.
The letter K and then the number 9 is how you find him.
Yeah.
He's on Facebook as well. He's on Instagram. You got Twitter too?
I got Twitter too. I want to say it's not just me. We got a whole team of people. They're all amazing. One of my good boys, Danny, he runs Jiu-Jitsu Life and Jit Life Fitness up in Seattle. He said a statement to me tonight. He said, Improve, don't prove. And that like changed my life, man. I'm about to write that down on my wall.
Nice.
Improve. Don't spend your time proving. Improve.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And that changed my whole life. And that's basically what we're doing here. So shout out to Danny.
All right. That's what's up, man. All right, John. Well, thanks so much, man. I appreciate it. It is about 8:35 here. So that's 11:35 there. I know you got to sleep. You got to get your rest, because I know you're going to be up at like 4 in the morning with these dogs.
That's true.
All right, man.
I appreciate you reaching out, though, man.
Thanks
appreciate
so
it.
Thanks a lot, man.
All
Take
right.
it easy. All right, bro. Talk to you soon. All right, bye-bye. All right, guys. That's another. That was long. That was super long. It was super insightful. I believe there's a lot of great information shared in that video. I'm trying to figure this stuff out. Like, this is new for me. You know, I'm a. What I love about these things is that, you know, these conversations that I have that we're kind of doing off the cuff live on air for you are conversations that I have all the time with dog people on the phone, in their yards, at dog shows and stuff like that. So that, you know, and I know there's a lot of information that helps me understand and have a whole different perspective about dogs and our relationships with them. So to bring that to you guys in the form of these videos, these live streams, I think is excellent. On the calendar right now, I have set up an interview with Lee Robinson. That's going to be Saturday morning, I believe, at 8:30, 9 o'clock, something like that. It's already set up. So if you guys look in the on my channel, you'll see the schedule time for that interview. That's Lee Robinson, American Sentinel Kennels, Band Dogs. A lot of you guys have been asking for that. So that's coming up on Saturday. Also talked to Lori and Gypsy, who have Rock of Ages Kennels. Don't have a schedule, don't have anything set yet for that interview, but that's Canis Panther. Hopefully we'll be doing that interview sometime next week. And I'm going to be doing a lot more of these. Additionally, I'm going to try to get back out and start doing some more actual filming of documentaries. I have a Chow Chow video that I'm going to try to knock out between tonight and tomorrow and have it up for you guys on Saturday morning. So that's all that's coming down the line on Dogumentary TV. I got a couple of super chats tonight. I was kind of engaged in the conversation with John, so I didn't really see him. Everyone who sent one, thank you so much for the donation. I appreciate that. All right, guys, this is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV. I will catch up with you guys very shortly, Saturday at the latest. All right? Peace.